Good afternoon. May I first briefly just introduce our three speakers, Olena Haleta, Maxim Tarnawsky, and Viktor Ostapchuk. Our session is dedicated to three of Ukraine's most stellar personalities who have had a lasting impact on Ukrainian cultural and political life, indeed an influence that lasts into our century. Ahatanhel Krymsky, the distinguished and brilliant Orientalist and scholar who founded the All-Ukrainian Academy of Sciences. Serhii Iefremov, statesman, erudite literary scholar, and leader of the social democratic movements in Ukraine. And Yuri Mezhenko, leading bibliographer and scholar, a fierce defender of Europeanism and modernism in literature, and the creator of the Ukrainian National Academy, National Library. May I first introduce the first speaker, Viktor Ostapchuk, who is professor of Near and Middle Eastern Civilization at the University of Toronto, has published widely on Ottoman history, and is editor-in-chief of the Harvard Ukrainian series on Ottoman documents pertaining to Ukraine and the Black Sea countries. He has also been active connected to the Ahatanhel Krymsky Institute of Oriental Studies of the National Academy of Sciences. So appropriately, he will speak about Ahatanhel Krymsky, please.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank Mark Andrejczyk for inviting me to give this talk. It's ironic that I spent 93 to 99 at the Krymsky Institute of Oriental Studies in Kyiv, this was a figure that I never really took very seriously. I'm an Ottoman historian, 16th, 17th century. And of course, he's an amazing individual, but I never really dug into his works and as much as I did now for this presentation. So that's something I'll talk about at the end, the problematic ambivalence that we can have towards Ahatanhel Krymsky. So again, I said I'm not a specialist. I don't work in the 20th century, so I don't. As far as Krymsky goes. The man in the institution. Well, here the man was slight man was quite a giant. He has been studied quite assiduously since the 70s, but especially in years of independence, by people like Lena Tsikhankova, Matveeva, even Igor Hirich, and of course Slimia Pavlichko's last unfinished work, which was published. So this, of course, 1871 to 1942 are his dates. He's known as a polyglot, prodigious, knew 30 languages well, supposedly, and another 30, basically. Apparently he knew them well, and apparently he was able to learn languages even at an old age. So obviously, clearly a prodigious genius. He himself was in his own words, on his father's side, he goes back to the Crimean Tatars, Lithuanian Tatars, late 17th century, when some groups left the Crimea, and he dates himself, one of his forefathers, back to Mstislav in the Russian in 1698. And his mother was a Polish from Lithuanian Pole. He himself was born in Volodymyr-Volinsk, but spent only a couple months there. And his father, who was a teacher, eventually they moved to Zvenigorodko, which is south of Kyiv, in South Kyivan province, southern Kyivan province. In 1881, he studied in Ostrih in the proto-gymnasium. And in 1884, he ended up in Kyiv. Beginning his secondary education, and by 85 he joined the Pavlo Halahan or Galagan Collegium, which is a kind of an elite school, and it was there that he really gained his national consciousness, though there were, well, impulses before that. He, it's interesting, the school was, in his own tellings, the school was, half of it was aristocratic kids, rich kids, private school, half of it was stipendiary students, which he was one of them, poor, and the rich kids would pick on the small, on the poor kids, or try to you know, subordinate them. And it's something that he really hated. It just hurt him, burned him to the soul. There was this class consciousness that he had, the next moment was, and I guess his family was completely Russified. I mean, this is his house in Zvenihorodka, which is still, was rebuilt actually by the Academy of Sciences. It's a long story. This is his father, who was basically a Russified individual. And his brother as well. He had great discussion with his brother about the Ukrainian matters. But he writes that he was affected by Drahomanov's writings, introduction of Drahomanov to Fedkovich's stories. He says that at the academy he was one day he started reading this and he had basically an epiphany. He saw a light shined upon him. He says. He understood that he had to be a Ukrainophile wholeheartedly. This was greedily he would pursue Ukrainstvo, Ukrainianism. He wrote this letter to Hrinchenko later in the 1890s. And he did all his course well in his courses, so in his spare time he studied, was keen on studying all things Ukrainian, every spare moment of his life, of his time, he would say. And of course, since there was no Ukraine at the time, for him the important thing was the people and the language. He was extremely keen on the language, and he decided he was going to serve his patria, his nenka, by gaining broad knowledge about the world. In 1889, he ends up in Moscow at the Lazarev Institute of Oriental Languages, and there he gets tied into Ukrainian affairs as well. He's very keen on what's going on in Galicia. He subscribes to all the newspapers, and Narod, Dilo, and others, and he starts writing articles, polemicizing, discussing. At one point, he has a falling out with Drahomanov, for example. Anyway, he pursues Oriental languages. He's an Arabist, first of all, and also studied Persian. And of course, again, he knew many, many languages. But after his first degree in 1892, he entered Moscow University to study Slavic studies. And by this time, he was already had quite a bit of notoriety he was known about. So that in 1894, when Ohonovsky, who had a chair of Ruthenian Ukrainian philology in Lviv University, died, Krymsky was thought to be the man to take this position. Zhushevsky had come 2 years earlier in 1892 to Lviv from Greater Ukraine, and so Krymsky was considered the candidate. But it was because of bureaucratic problems and so forth, he decided no, he was going to do it. But he had a decision to make, whether to go. Normally, I mean, he was known about, he was heard about in Petersburg, which was the center of Oriental studies, of serious research Oriental studies. And there was an attempt to bring him there, but he didn't want to go for two reasons. One was it's not quite clear to me why this had to be. He thought that he would be cut off from Ukrainian things if he went to Petersburg. Somewhere in Moscow was a better place for him to be. And then also he was not particularly interested in research. He was a brilliant, intelligent man, wrote well, but he delayed his dissertation for a long time because he wrote to his professor saying, this isn't what I want to do. So he had this degree in Oriental languages and Slavic philology, and he decided not to go to Petersburg. And he ended up going to Beirut for 2 years in 96 to 99, 98. That's the only time that he spent in the so-called East, except for Azerbaijan, I mean, but. So, he prominent instructor of Semitic languages, of translation of Arabic into Russian, studied the Quran, many textbooks and so forth, and very prolific, but not really very interested in doing cutting edge research. But he's already quite a prominent figure. So in 1918, when during the Hetmanate, when Vernadsky is he was the one that was the first head of the Ukrainian Academy of Sciences. There was already talk that we have to bring Krymsky over. We have to bring him down to Kyiv. And should I skip? This is his father. Not much, but look like a school teacher. This is the Dr. Habis. This is his brother, and this is his father. And there's a picture of him in about 1900. You can see he looks kind of Turkic. And this is actually a problem for him because he was influenced by theories of Ernst Renan, famous French Semitist and philosopher historian, that the Turks are somehow people that are not capable of higher culture. He was influenced by these ideas. For him, it was an issue, and he was ambivalent towards this because later on he was quite supportive of the Crimean Tatars and quite interested in them. In any event, so he comes down, he's invited down, and he... I wanted to find the slide, but I couldn't. I'm not even sure now if I dreamed it or saw it, but there's supposed to be a picture of him with a freight car, an entire freight car full of books that he brought down from Moscow to Kyiv. He had tens of thousands of books in Oriental studies, especially which were lacking in Kyiv, so this is, of course, very important. He becomes the neodmienny sekretar, or the permanent secretary of the Academy of Sciences, which is the position he has until 1918. This is the period, for me, the Ukrainian Revolution is really the 1920s, not until 21, because this is the period of his activity, for example, when the Academy is being formed and the struggles are going on. In any event, this is a period of prodigious activity, both in Oriental studies, in Ukrainian studies, and in running the Academy, basically. Just to give you an idea of some of the positions that he held. Of course, he chaired the Cabinet of Arabic, Iranian Philology and Turkology, where he did much of the writing himself. There were very few cadres, actually. There's no pay. People started. He had an Arabist. Kesma was from Lebanon who he had there. But he's also director of the Institute of Ukrainian Language in 1921. Worked in 1918-1920. Worked as the professor of world history at Kyiv University. He's the editor in chief of the Annals of the Historical Philological branch of the Ukrainian Academy of Sciences. 1925, he was the head of the Kyiv filial of the All Union Association of Orientalists, and then later on, member of the All Ukrainian Association. He was very, very involved in day-to-day running of the Academy. For example, in 1921, he basically played a large role in writing the new statute when it became the VUAN, the All-Ukrainian Academy of Sciences. And scholars were not getting paid, they were not getting benefits. So he worked out both the statute, the bylaws, and he would work out all the practical matters of funding the Academy, funding scholars, funding them if the academician died, what would happen to his family, things like that. He actually arranged all these things. Saw a lot of financial administrative things, getting buildings. Together with Iefremov, of course, which Maxim will talk about, it was sort of known as the Krymsky Akademia Nauk, or the Krymsky Iefremovska Akademia Nauk, the Crimean, Krymsky Academy of Sciences. As far as the Ukrainian language, it played a very important role. He was very involved in the orthography, norms of lexicography, scholarly, scientific, technical terminology. He was involved in the controversy between, basically he favored Eastern Ukrainian versus Galician. There were big battles about, for example, whether the reflexive xia should be connected or not. Of course, he thought it should be connected to the word. He spent a lot of time, and it comes out in Yefremov's diary, working on this Russian-Ukrainian multi-volume dictionary, and he wouldn't he really wanted to control it. I think this was an important project for him because obviously he wanted to enrich the Ukrainian language. It's very interesting. He was very, very savvy, very, very crafty working with politicians. He was actually a very political person. He was never formally in politics, but it's pretty clear that he was a devout Ukrainophile nationalist, even called himself, had a different meaning then. It was very easy when he was rehabilitated in 1956, and then more in the 70s. It was very easy for Ukrainian Soviet scholars to write about him because for example, when he was in the Lazarev Institute in Moscow when the revolution occurred, the October Revolution in 1917, he wrote a greeting on the behalf to the Soviets from the Lazarev Institute, and it was very right on the language. It was very easy, so he had no trouble talking with communicating with Bolsheviks, it was I wouldn't call it complete insincerity. Basically, he knew it. He was very pragmatic about what to do, but also he did have this. The people for him were Ukrainians, right? Were peasants, so he was attached to the people, so to say. But he was very anti-Marxist, but he could play the game very well. For example, when it looked like the whites were going to take over, he was even thinking of going and talking to the Denikins to see if he could save the academy. It didn't happen. It was impossible anyway. In 1919, just to give you an example, this goes back to way at the end of his career. In 1939-40, when the Soviets invaded Finland, he went out and said some amazing, statement. He said, "If I was young, I would go and take a rifle and go fight in this war." With the White Finns, they were called Bielefina, and I would. But unfortunately, I'm too old, and I can hardly pick up a rifle. But I know Finnish, and I'm ready to go to the front there and translate Finnish. So he was really, obviously, he could really play the game. One of the things that the theme of his activity in the 20s was basically to fight to keep the academy independent, okay, to keep it, keep it out of control of politicians. And of course, this is a very difficult thing to do with the Bolsheviks. Basically, something of struggle we call today academic freedom that he was very much involved in. The conflict was, of course, to have a state-funded institution, but to keep its independence from politicians, from the state. Great controversies, great struggles was between him and Hrushevsky. Hrushevsky returned in 1924, Hrushevsky, of course, himself always envisioned an academy of science. He envisioned, of course, the Antesha, the Shevchenko Scientific Society, was an academy, de facto became an academy. He formed the Ukrainian Naukovo-Tovaryshstvo, the Ukrainian Scientific Society in Kyiv in 1907. And when the Hetmanate coup happened, of course, Hrushevsky was out, and he refused to have anything to do with the academy, though he was offered to be a part of it. And he went into immigration. In 1924, when he came back, he became the head of the historical section there, of the Historical Commission. By that time, Krymsky was very much in charge of the academy, essentially. There was part of the problem was perhaps Krymsky had more of a philological bent, and there was maybe a direction, more of an stress on philology at the academy. But it was a clash of, I mean, of, obviously of personalities and as well as principles. Hrushevsky, of course, wanted to build up his sphere, get funding, get a building, which eventually did. And he would go beyond, he'd go around Krymsky, who was in the presidium, go directly to Kharkiv. And this is an interesting dynamic we have here. Actually, all of these guys, they all have to go to Kharkiv to get money, to get backing and so forth. There's a great line in Yefremov's diary where he talks about Krymsky having going to the Orda, going to the horde, like Danilo Halisky in the Primary Chronicle goes to that, to drink kumis. As Danilo Halisky did the Primary Chronicle, drink kumis with Bati and so forth. And he would come back. He was usually very successful in getting funding and finding his way. But Hrushevsky did the same kind of thing. They would both Hrushevsky would try to go around him, go directly to when Skripnik was in power. Skripnik was very much pro-Hrushevsky for the time being. And they were basically, this controversy got so bad that it broke into public scandals during meetings of the presidium. The party officials apparently, it's clear that they didn't trust either of them. They knew what they were both about, or the government officials. They basically used them. By 1928, when Krymsky is removed from the permanent secretaryship, by that time Hrushevsky and Krymsky both realize that they had overdone it, and they actually tried to make amends. This could be a tragic opera, except there'd be very few females in this, but. It was this very dramatic struggle. All of a sudden, it was too late. And by that time, in 1928, he was removed. In 1929, he lost the directorship of the historical philological segment. And essentially, the academy was, by that time, destroyed as such, as an independent, academically free institution. A few words about his legacy. In independent Ukraine, the institute, of course, was named after him, Institute of Oriental Studies in Kyiv, which only on Pritsakop opened up. There's been quite a bit of interest in him, studies by people like Ellen Sihankova and lots of archival work, both in secret police archives and others, but no one's really written. The closest anyone's come to writing a biography of this complicated man was actually Slumia Pavlichko, looked at his sexuality, for example. There's quite a lot of evidence pointing to, because of homoerotic lines that he had in his lines, so that he probably never married. It's quite clear that he was probably homosexual. So there's that angle to it. But a person that could no proper biographies have been written about him. He was a man, a very conflicted, ambivalent person. He could have been a great Orientalist, he knew German, French beautifully. He never wrote in any foreign language other than Russian, Ukrainian. So he wrote most of the Brockhaus and Ephraim articles on the Middle East and Islamic world, but nothing in the Encyclopedia of Islam, for example, which was the international venue for Oriental studies. So on one hand, we have this kind of this. Most of his works. The interesting thing about him is because he knew the languages and he wrote very well and he was very erudite, he was also very much full of insight. His works a lot of it is of course outdated, but one is struck sometimes by his intelligence, his originality. In the 30s, when he was completely He was living in Zvenorodka, very poor, and in Kyiv, but he was did a lot of writing. He wrote a six-volume history of the Khazars, which never came out. So on the one hand, you have kind of this cult of personality of Krymsky, of him being studied, and works are being republished. Some are outdated, yet they're interesting. But I can give two examples of where he his works have lasting interest. His History of Turkey, which was actually republished when I was at the Academy in the 1990s. It has a lot of the old myths and things from Chronicles and so forth, but he was an Arabist and he knew Arabic better than most Ottomanists, so he had those sources covered very well. He's also very good writer, made very good portraits of individuals, of sultans, personality studies. And he also, thanks to his huge library and his linguistic ability, he covered better than any Ottomanist the Western literature in Latin, German, French, Italian, contemporary literature, which books that he had that was part of his library. And for example, his guide to this literature is an appendix to this history, is the best, probably the best available guide to contemporary Western literature on the Ottomans. Another example is in the 30s he wrote Historia Novoj Arabskoj Literatury, a 600-page book that didn't come out in his time. So it's basically starting in the 7th century, but goes mostly 19th century. It is considered by some Arabists to be the best survey of Arabic literature, of modern Arabic literature, not just because for bibliographic reasons, but being a survey, but also because of his insights. And in fact, it was going to be translated into Arabic, but because of funds didn't come through, it never happened. It's a book that probably should have come out in English, but you know. There you have. So he made his choices. He was obviously, instead of becoming a world renowned, known today Orientalist, this love of Ukraine, of Ukrainianism. He talks about in his writings how he came back to Ukraine and he would lie down once and kiss the earth. And, you know, he just loved the country. And doing this, and of course, he had made a huge impact on Ukrainian studies, and Ukrainian philology, So very conflicting and interesting person. It's really looking at him now. It's really remarkable that one can find quite a bit of interesting things. But again, it's most of it is a language that people the world doesn't know. So that's always a problem. So that's it.
Thank you so much. Thank you for for a most informative paper. Certainly about a brilliant personality who contributed or laid foundations for Ukrainian scholarship in the field of Oriental studies and in Ottoman studies. So let us proceed now to our second speaker. And our second speaker today Maxim Tarnawsky, who is professor of Slavic languages and literatures at the University of Toronto. He is an authority of 19th and 20th century Ukrainian novel. He's currently working on Ivan Franko. And his most recent publications, he has several, has been on Ivan Nechulevitsky, The All-Encompassing Eye of Ukraine. Ivan Nechulevitsky, The Realist Prose, which has just been translated into Ukrainian. So I give you Maxim Tarnawsky.
Thank you, Miroslava. First of all, I want to thank Marko for inviting me to this conference and thank all of you for resisting the sunlight in favor of enlightenment. I hope it's enlightenment. Yeah. Sunlight may be better. Let me begin, because Iefremov is a huge personality and an important person in Ukrainian intellectual history, in Ukrainian cultural history. And so I want to deflate your expectations radically here. That is, I do not intend to do what my colleague was doing. I will not be giving you a biography of Iefremov, which needs to be written, has not been written. He has a very long and complicated life. I will not even be trying to analyze his intellectual contribution or even his intellectual views on any particular subject. What I want to do very particularly is to look at his autobiographical writing, of which there is a great deal, and if you know any Yefremov, you probably know the diaries from the 1920s, which are a fascinating document. There is also a diary from the 1895 period, and there is also a long memoir, Iz New Minulik. Now, that's essentially the corpus I'm looking at. And to use those documents to uncover essentially two characteristics of his personality, which I think help tell us something about the spirit of the times, the atmosphere, and the difficulties and accomplishments that Ukrainian politicians and intellectuals had in that period. I'm also very grateful to Victor for mentioning the diary and how it treats Krymsky. Of course, in his presentation, it was very positive treatment of Krymsky. You'll discover in a moment that that's not really what Yefremov thought of Krymsky. In any case, Serhii Yefremov was one of the major figures of Ukrainian political and cultural life in the period before, during, and after the establishment of Ukrainian statehood in 1721. If nothing else, his role as the deputy head of the Central Rada secures him in this pantheon. But his role was much larger than that of a government functionary. He was one of the key individuals whose journalistic and political activities led to the establishment of the Ukrainian state, and he was one of the important voices shaping the policies of the Ukrainian state. In all of his activities, he was guided by a particular set of cultural and political ideas, which were an outgrowth of his particular understanding of the challenges facing the Ukrainian nation and its culture. In this, he serves to some extent as an exemplary figure of the spirit of the times that led to Ukrainian statehood and to the problems that led to its demise. This exemplary role continued after the eventual Bolshevik victory and characterized his life and pursuits until his arrest and eventual death. And beyond even that, Yefremov, through his journalism, his memoirs, and his diaries, is certainly one of the most extensive chroniclers of this period in Ukrainian history. He deserves our attention. In the spirit of full disclosure, I must also add that for me personally, Yefremov is a small blot on my conscience. In my book on Ivan Nechui-Levesky, I needed a scapegoat, someone to blame for the traditional misreading of Nechui that I aimed to correct. And Yefremov fit the bill. Actually, he fit the bill very well. And he really was responsible for the skewed image of Nechui. But this one matter does not make him a scoundrel or a malicious liar. So by examining his person and his accomplishments in a wider context, I hope to straighten whatever small dents I may have put in his reputation. If that sounds like I come to bury Caesar and not to praise him well. And yet, the relationship between Yefremov and Nechui does highlight a very important quality of the younger writer. He was a very headstrong and self-confident man who was never shy in expressing an opinion and was certainly quick to criticize others. His diaries and memoirs exhibit this quality in great detail and frequency. He was always arguing with someone, and when he did, he was belligerent and unrestrained. Despite his strong religious upbringing, he's the son of a priest, Yefremov was not one to turn the other cheek or seek compromise or reconciliation. Some of that, perhaps, was a quality of the times. But his autobiographical texts make it abundantly clear that he was always ready to find fault with others, to blame them for the failure of collective projects and for frictions and problems in public and personal relations between him and them. Paradoxically, a man who was so intimately involved in very many of the most significant collective, political, cultural, and entrepreneurial projects of his times was a highly partisan and self-centered participant with a strong sense of the categorical superiority of his own views on a given matter. This pugnacity was not limited to the public sphere. In his published diary from 1895, for example, a 19-year-old Yefremov, still a student at the Kyiv Theological Seminary, recounts a trip home to his parental house during the summer vacation of 1895. He would rather not be going, he says, but he's still young enough to feel the need to behave like a dutiful son and come home while school's out. It doesn't help that he lives with his older brother in KU, who is the rector of the seminary, thus adding more pressure to uphold family ties. But there's a problem. Serhii is in reasonably good relations with his parents, but his sister, Paraskeva, has recently married, and the young couple who live in Shostakove, a village only a short distance from the Yefremov home in Paichik, have had a major argument with the senior Yefremov, Reverend Alexander. The two couples no longer speak to each other. The animosity is so high that the elder couple did not even attend the funeral of their grandchild, Paraska's first child, that died shortly after birth. Tensions are very high, and Serhii knows he will be expected to side with his parents against his sister. But he does nothing of the sort. 3 days after his arrival at his family home, he decamps for 2 days to Shostakove, dramatically voting with his feet in the matter of the family squabble. He counsels and hopes for reconciliation, but ends up enduring accusations of betrayal and spends at least 3 of his 7 weeks at home away from the family hearth, in the home of his married brother or at Paraska's. Serhii may have succumbed to a feeling of family loyalty or duty to come home, but he certainly feels no restraint about getting involved in someone else's argument and even taking sides against his own parents. This minor episode has a further depth that is not at first apparent. In his diary, Serhii Yefremov never explains the cause of the argument between his parents and Paraska's family, except to suggest it was specifically with her husband. Perhaps the cause was explained in earlier volumes of his diary that he destroyed in the face of police problems. But one way or another, Serhii had a very personal stake in this family squabble that the other participants did not know about because he kept it secret from them. Shortly before this time, Serhii had fallen in love with Onesha Durdukiuska, a priest's daughter. Indeed, from this point forward, when he wasn't in prison, Serhii lived the rest of his life with her. But Onesha was the sister of Ivan Durdukiuski, the man Paraska had married, and with whom the senior Yefremovs were bickering. As children of Orthodox clergymen, Onesha and Serhii, whether by personal choice or through deference to convention, were bound by a strict version of religious rules governing family relations and marriage. In accordance with the affinity incest taboo, since their siblings were married, they were relatives and thus could not be married. Serhii rants about the injustice of this taboo in his diary, but he apparently never found any way to subvert it. In taking the side of his sister and brother-in-law against his parents, Serhii was literally siding with those whose marriage prevented his own. Perhaps it was the symbolic value of his clergyman father as the moral authority in enforcing the taboo that contributed to Serhii's anger. While the diary entries that recount the family argument are very vague, the substance of the arguments is never revealed or discussed, for example, it is clear that the vehemence of Serhii's emotions was amplified by his personal romantic circumstances. Yefremov was a bellicose and disputatious man, and for better or worse, these qualities of his personality affected every aspect of his public and private activities. Perhaps the best known manifestation of this argumentative temperament is seen in his comments on prominent individuals in the Academy of Sciences in his diary from 2329. Judging by what he says, there was hardly a decent individual in the whole Academy, excepting himself, of course. Among the most prominent and memorable figures from this diary are Mikhail Hrushevsky and Ahatanhel Krymsky. As they are described there, the former is all but the epicenter and mastermind of all villainy, while the latter is a pitiful and naive sexot. A typical diatribe occurs in a brief description of Olis Dosvitny in the entry for February 26, 1925. Yefremov accuses Dosvitny, who had fled to the United States to avoid execution in the Tsarist army, of absconding with funds destined for the Central Rada. By deliberately taking so long to travel from San Francisco to Ukraine via Japan, that by the time he arrived, the Central Rada no longer existed. Not only is the whole story more than a little dubious, but the logic of the accusation is impeccably self-serving. The fault, of course, lies not with the Central Rada, which couldn't stay in power for more than a few months, but with the messenger who didn't reach it in time. My point here is not to argue that Yefremov was a malicious gossip while Hrushevsky, Krymsky, and Dosvitny were saintly innocent victims. The story of incessant intrigues, political posturing, and backstabbing that Yefremov tells of the Academy of Science is hardly surprising in any large institution, particularly one consisting largely of alpha males with extraordinarily large egos. I have no doubt that the angry intransigence demonstrated by Yefremov was to some degree shared by the people he berates, and that the actual state of daily interactions in the academy and in other institutions was not as combative and problematical as these diary judgments suggest. Nevertheless, something important is missing. Whether on their own or in groups, all of these individuals were involved in major important projects. But the way Yefremov tells it, there is hardly any sense of common purpose, any shared responsibility for the success of a collective enterprise that is working towards shared goals. There's hardly any word of cooperation or compromise. This is particularly jarring in light of the actual political situation. Both Yefremov and the assorted colleagues he derides were in fact working against a shared and very real enemy, the communist state apparatus, which would eventually bring them all down. In these circumstances, it would not be strange or psychologically unlikely to discover a sense of shared victimization or of sympathetic appreciation for different positions and of a willingness to compromise on some principles to help advance a shared cause. Of course, the NKVD was actively trying to prevent such convergence and foster divisions among the Ukrainian intellectuals, and Yefremov makes it clear in his diary that he understands this. But that doesn't lead to expressions of goodwill and mutual understanding. In their struggle to defend Ukrainian culture and identity from the Russifying assault of the party, Ukrainian intellectuals were largely disorganized and estranged from each other. Although they likely understood that they were collectively engaged in a battle against a powerful common enemy, their mutual animosities, suspicions, and mistrust created an atmosphere that made success even less likely than it would have otherwise. Whether it be in the Academy of Science or on the pages of Ukrainian literary journals, where various writers and literary groupings gleefully attacked each other with great venom and passion, among the cultural intelligentsia, there was little room for common purpose and accommodation in the 1920s when Ukrainian culture and identity was permitted a limited development. During the revolution itself, something similar was at play, although the level of cooperation was perhaps somewhat higher. Yefremov occasionally recalls events and personalities from that time in his diary from the 1920s, but there is no systematic description. He left no personal writings from 1718, although he did produce a great deal of journalism at that time, which left no doubt about the difficulties of finding compromise among the various competing political interests and personalities. For example, in the days immediately before the proclamation of Ukrainian independence in the Fourth Universal on January 9, 1918, Yefremov was publicly arguing against independence, although he did vote for it in the Rada. His understanding of the political climate of the times is best gleaned from the later chapters of his memoirs, Prudni Minuli, where he recounts his activities in the years 1905-07. Since he wrote these memoirs in 1920-21, before his amnesty, when he was still living on the lam in KU, they actually reflect his thinking after the events of the revolution. Characteristically, he focuses on the bickering between the various Ukrainian political parties and the infighting within them. Yefremov's memoirs highlight another important quality of his personality that gets reinforced through his biographical experiences. From today's vantage point, Yefremov is best known as a literary figure. Indeed, this was his own goal early in life. From his youthful days as a pupil in the Orthodox school in Umань, Yefremov dreams of being a writer, or at least so he tells us in his memoirs 30 years later. In his years at the seminary in Kyiv, Yefremov is trying his hand at writing fiction, and in later years, he will actually have some success in getting published. But in the diary entries from 1895, where he discusses the reading group that seminarians have formed, he pays more attention to the infighting in the group than to what they read. Who has paid their dues? Who determines what is subscribed and read? Who gets to keep the material for how long and in what order? This is not just the angry Yefremov ever ready to pick an argument with someone. This is also a strong indication of the nature of his primary concerns. Even when it comes to literature, justice is at least a parallel, if not preeminent, consideration. It's not that Yefremov does not express an interest in the aesthetic virtues and intellectual manner of literary works in his diary, but his innate concern for fair play seems to take precedence over other considerations. He spends more time describing how the various reading clubs were formed, organized, and governed than he does in analyzing the literary works he consumes. But there's one great exception to this general principle, theater. Yefremov was a great lover of theater, and his reactions to various performances are a frequent element of his biographical writing. Yet here, too, his attention is not really focused on the content of the plays, which was admittedly not very substantial when we're speaking of pre-revolutionary theater, but on the actors and their ability to affect the audience with their skill. It's the effectiveness of the spectacle, its ability to arouse sentiment, that he consistently puts at the center of his judgment. That's why he will later criticize Kurbasi's Berezil theater productions and compare them unfavorably to Staritsky's traditional approach. Yefremov's focus on justice and fair play, particularly as they are applied to social questions, is evident in a number of emblematic biographical events that he recounts in his diary and memoirs. As a student at Kyiv Seminary, Yefremov was the recipient of a very old-fashioned philological education. In his accounts of this institution, Yefremov is, like many seminarians who are not interested in a religious vocation, quite blunt in his appraisal of the low intellectual quality of instruction, although he does occasionally mention instructors who were intelligent and conscientious. Unlike other seminarians, Serhii Yefremov endured the additional burden of being under the watchful eye of his very conservative older brother, who was for a time the rector of the academy and went on to become a bishop. Although this relationship sometimes worked in his favor by protecting him from punishment, on the whole, he found the seminary and his brother's attention stifling, oppressive, and useless. So eventually, he switched from the academy to Kyiv University, where he entered the Faculty of Law and earned a degree as a lawyer. But why would a budding writer study law rather than philology or history? The answer lies, of course, in that tension that characterized Yefremov's thinking. His interest in literature was abstract. His interest in social justice was concrete. A degree in law would put him on a path that would more clearly lead in that direction. Of course, Yefremov never worked as a lawyer and later conceded that his decision to study law was impractical and largely useless. But it did put him in the midst of various student political groups at the university while he was there. Another biographical episode that illustrates his commitment to social justice concerns his conscription into the Tsarist army. For reasons he does not entirely clarify, Yefremov ignored his obligation for military service. He was a man with a pulmonary health issue that should have exempted him from conscription a priori, as it eventually did after the fact, but he did not pursue this opportunity. As a university graduate, he was entitled to service at a higher rank, but this too he did not pursue. So out of the blue, more or less, he gets a notice to appear for service, which he dutifully follows. The story that comes out makes for excellent reading and involves a range of anecdotal material of all sorts, including a completely unexpected visit to Ahatanhel Krymsky in his home in Zvenihorodka. But the major point of Yefremov's story is to underscore the enormous injustice endured by conscripts in the army, a fate he mostly avoids and observes at approximate distance because as a university graduate, he is treated differently, despite the fact that he did not take advantage of the official route by which university graduates avoid the horrors of rank and file service. In the final analysis, Yefremov tells a story in which he is not really a victim, but rather a witness, since he himself was living in somewhat privileged circumstances, of the abuse inflicted on conscripts in the Russian army. An experience that might have been framed as a testimony of personal suffering is instead treated as an indictment of social problems. Yefremov will later do something similar when he describes his first experience in prison. Yefremov's interest in social issues, his choice of social activism over literary fiction, is a reflection of a larger shift in the spirit of Ukrainian activism, and indeed revolutionary activity of all kinds in the Russian Empire at the beginning of the 20th century. Yefremov makes this very explicit in his memoirs. Whereas the earlier generation of Ukrainian activists had largely focused on matters of cultural identity and had limited their activities to publicizing and promoting this identity, Yefremov and many other younger activists believed that these methods and goals were inadequate. In his memoirs and diary, he makes frequent disparaging remarks about those Ukrainophile activists, particularly in the Hromada, who were unwilling to upgrade their goals and their methods to meet the needs and the possibilities of a new era. Specifically, Yefremov saw the need to move from a cultural to a political approach to Ukrainian activism. The first and most important step in this new approach was the creation of institutions. Their creation would transform the Ukrainian movement from a private endeavor that relied on the selfless altruism of individual activists to a social program rooted in public and private institutions. Yefremov understood the usefulness of creating facts on the ground, so to speak, rather than promoting ideals. To a large extent, his entire life as Ukrainian activist consisted of such institution-building activities. His creation of the Vik Publishing House was such a venture, as was his participation in the first Ukrainian newspaper in the Russian Empire, Romachka Dumka, and its successor, Rada, where he was one of the principal contributors. And of course, his role in the Central Rada, the first modern government, was also a manifestation of this predilection for institution building, as was his participation in the All-Ukrainian Academy of Sciences. Throughout his various endeavors, however, Yefremov displays a strong inclination to focus on two of his innate core values, the word and the nation. Even in purely political circumstances, Yefremov was often focused on language and identity. Much of his earliest political activity was directed at overturning the restrictions on Ukrainian promulgated by the MZUKAS. But his passion for national culture found its greatest expression in the attention he gave literature. As a publisher, as a publicist, and as a scholar, Yefremov was always launching plans for yet another literary project. The Vik Publishing House, for example, was not just an institution itself. Its goal was to turn Ukrainian literature into a public institution. The anthology that was its first project and was meant to project the illusion of a vibrant literary landscape, an existing and immutable fact rather than a struggle towards aspirational goals. The best evidence of its success was found in the angry complaints of all the authors, mostly modernists, whom Yefremov had left out of the anthology. Everyone understood that the collection represented a cultural pantheon, a material embodiment of the state of Ukrainian literary life, and no one wanted to be left out, not even those who knew that Yefremov did not particularly care for their writing. A similar idea informed much of his literary criticism. Yefremov's overriding goal was always to demonstrate that such a literature existed, that it reflected the national will, and that it followed a pattern determined by its own internal dynamics. These goals are most particularly apparent in his two major accomplishments as a literary scholar. The first is his History of Ukrainian Writing, first published in 1911, and then revised and reissued in subsequent years. The second is the sequence of literary biographies, Kuchubinsky, Karpenko-Kari, Nechuy-Levitsky, Mirny, that he produced in the 1920s. While all these works are best known today for laying out a peculiar populist vision of the role of literature in Ukrainian society, they were in their own time tangible monuments to the existence of Ukrainian literature. Yefremov was, throughout his life, a builder, a doer, a creator of institutional facts on the ground. His literary criticism is a projection of his understanding of the need to produce manifest symbols, palpable works, public organizations, and institutions. One of the great ironies of his life then lies in the fact that when the Soviet authorities finally decided to attack him and accuse him of actually doing something, they had to invent an institution whose creation they could charge him with. The ones he had already created could not be turned against him. Yefremov's legacy, both in the reflection of the disunity that characterized Ukrainian organizations and in the understanding of the need to create institutional pillars for their cause, marks him as an important witness of the events of the Ukrainian Revolution and an embodiment of its problems and paradoxes. Thank you.
Thank you, Maxim, for a certainly profound insight into the personality of this controversial figure, who for me, as far as I know, remember, this is two-volume edition of Ukrainian literature, and as pedestrian as it may seem from our point of view of the 21st century, it still is a tremendous, you know, attempt at creating some kind of a synthesis of the Ukrainian literary process. And for that, I'm grateful. Now we will turn to our third speaker, and that is Olena Haleta, who is professor of comparative literature and literary theory at the Lviv National University and at the Ukrainian Catholic University in Lviv. She has been a visiting professor at several European, Canadian, and American universities, including Columbia University, and she is the author of many publications and a major monograph from anthology to ontology, as well as editor of several, academic literary series. So may I present Olena Haleta on our on Yuri Mezhenko.
Thank you very much for introducing me, and thank you very much to Marko Andrejczyk for inviting. It's a big honor for me to participate in this conference 6 years ago. I have conducted here my research, not this one, but yes, I'm really glad to present my research dedicated to Yuri Mezhenko as one of the most prominent Ukrainian literary critics and theoretic of the literature of the period we analyzed, and also very famous as librarian and founder of the National Library of Ukraine and also the Book Chamber of Ukraine. I tried to combine this two different approach to this period. From one side, to pay attention to the revolutionary situation or revolutionary project by Yuri Mezhenko, because a concept of revolution is one of the key concepts of his writings. But Yuri Mezhenko is not politician, and I'm not historian, so I will try to pay attention also to the history of ideas and even to the history of feelings, as typical for this situation. From the other side, I also try to analyze this project of the National Library as traditional building, what means a building of tradition. At the same time, library is a traditional kind of institution, and why it is needed in the revolutionary situation establish such traditional institution. Mezhenko's archive recently opened to the researchers at the Shevchenko Institute of Literature, Ukrainian National Academy, offers unique materials showing an interconnection between everyday life in the dramatically changed world and liturgy and institutional building as an attempt to describe, articulate, and also organize this world. Yuri Ivanov Mezhenko was born in Ukraine in Kharkiv in 1892. He graduated from school in Chernihiv, where he moved when his family as a child. And after that, he decided to move to Russia and to study at the Moscow University. What is interesting, Mezhenko was born and grown up in a Russian-speaking family, and he never lived in Kyiv before 1917. He just visited the city as a child with his mother for several times, and as he wrote in his diaries in the middle 30s, he was really impressed by this city, and he also realized that Kyiv, but not Petersburg or Moscow, was a cultural center for this region. In 1917, Mezhenko went from Moscow to Kyiv dreaming of revolution as an aesthetic occasion. He spent in this city about 10 years reading as one of the most famous literary critics and classifying as a founder of the National Library and Ukrainian Book Chamber all the books written during that time. That's not a metaphor, because in the middle of the 60s, Mezhenko became a very important resource person for researchers who tried to analyze this period. For example, we could analyze letters from Ivan Pivtoradny to Yuri Mezhenko. He asked him about different pseudonyms, rare editions, something like that, and Mezhenko described and analyzed this book. But the first creative work, to say, by Yuri Mezhenko became his own name. As we can verify from the documents, including the university record book and qualification research, the name Mezhenko didn't appear in his documents before 1917. Despite the fact that one of his grandfather on his mother's side actually had a double surname, Ivanov Mezhenko. Mezhenko wrote about this facts in his diaries a bit later. Mezhenko, actually Ivanov, started to use a name Mezhenko that means borderman only from 1917, as seen in his Russian international passport and travel documents. Numerous works he had signed by only name Mezhenko, stressing the meaning of the word, of this word. One of the key concepts used for description of the analyzed period, 1917-1921, used by Mezhenko had been a term revolution. In contemporary studies, it's understood in several from the several methodological perspectives. Not that the political meaning of this term is dominated now, but, for example, from an existentialistic perspective, as represented by Jasper Sartre or Hannah Arendt, revolution is seen as a limit situation that forces to make choice and thus acquires a historical dimension. If it's understood as an event in sense of Bayeux or Lefebvre, a revolution could be described as the dynamic unity of the moments of uncertainty and tendencies to consolidate the new norms. And from an anthropological point of view, so-called revolutionary situation could be also defined by a few concepts that can be seen as clearly positive or negative: uncertainty, freedom, and choice. On the anthropological level, they describe a situation as promising and disturbing. Then restriction disappeared, but the responsibility is enhanced. By Mikhail Yampolsky, revolution does not leave space for an outside observer. A revolution became for Ukrainian intellectualist of 20s an inescapable event which requires both engagement and reflection. For Mezhenko, it's also interesting and important to remember that a revolution always took definite place and has its own durability. For Mezhenko, the place of this revolution he was interested in was Kyiv. This city was for him a place of history and place out of history. From one side, it means that in this place everything is possible, and at the same time nothing is defined and limited by the past. Mezhenko activities in Ukraine are closely connected with Kyiv, where he started job after spending several months with his father's family in Chernivtsi. He also strongly identifies Ukraine as his own country, as it could be seen from his diaries of the 30s and then of 40s. Mezhenko sees Kyiv as a potential city, what means that everything should be built, should be established. What also means that it is needed personal emotional involvement and intellectual contribution. Changes of political regime has been only an integrated part of broader historical landscape, including political perturbation and disasters, epochal scientific discoveries, achievements and disappointments of philosophical faults, change and coexistence of different philosophical paradigms. Not only social context, but also time correlation has been changed. Past and future were considered as dependent on the current moment. Very interesting to read Mezhenko's lyrical chapter or a diary by Yuri Mezhenko, written in 1919. It contains only several notes, but the beginning is very remarkable. Mezhenko understood that here colleagues are going to be really remarkable historical persons, peoples, and participate in this process of historical building and traditional building. Mezhenko, talking on Ukrainian liturgy on 1920s, as a liturgy of revolution is a definition by Mezhenko, and a liturgy in revolution, he had almost never mentioned in his writing neither October Revolution nor other historical events. He defines a revolution as a more complicated and broader historical circumstances or a time of great opportunities and great events, as he said in 1919, as a chance to create a renewed man. He stressed a key role of creative person in theoretical article Individual Creation and a Collective, published in magazine Musahed in 1919. Michel de Certeau much later claimed, each individual is a locus in which an incoherent and often contradictory plurality of relational determination interact. But revolution usually destroys different kinds of determinations. As for Mezhenko, and that is another side of the question, in such a situation, individual become who is able to create and express new meanings which could be the basis for the new discourse and new structures of everyday life. In other words, Mezhenko saw in individual Bas as a creator and as a creation of revolutionary situation. Mezhenko even proposed his own plan of creating or recreating city, in this case Kyiv, as a ground for modern tradition. First of all, he stressed the importance of the National Library as an institution which represents a recognized tradition. Secondly, he also proposed his own publishing and translation program. He also underlined a role of educational system, especially Ukrainian language school in Ukraine. And finally, he tried to develop different literary and art groups or communities and literary and scientific periodicals. As we know, Mezhenko was an author of a very important theoretical article published in this first, and it was the last one also, issue of Muzahed magazine. And he also published here a review dedicated to Tichina Sonyashni Klarneti. But what is possible to find in to realize working with his archival documents? He was also an author of editorial board. He was an author of the program of editorial board because Mezhenko prepared this text, and after the general discussion, only some small remarks were done in this text. So Mezhenko was more interested in the internal, not the external dimension of revolutionary change. As he wrote, revolution took place not only in the squares and on the streets, but also in the offices of thinkers and rooms of dreamers. Here, he resonates with other European intellectualist, José Ortega y Gasset, who said that revolution is not a barricade, but a state of mind. But as bibliographer, Mezhenko saw a situation also from another perspective. At the beginning of the 20s, he noted a remarkable growth of book circulation. Despite poor economic condition, number of copies increased from 250 to 5, 10, and even 20,000, even in the case of poetry books. So books have become a means for readers to understand reality and to orient in unpredictable circumstances. In fact, Mezhenko describes the revolutionary situation as a period of being in between, when, by Antonio Gramsci, the old is dying and the new cannot be born. Gramsci uses also a word interregnum, accepted and developed by Zygmunt Bauman. Bauman said, times of interregnum are times of uncertainty. And he also stressed that interregnum has its temporal, to wit, diachronic, but also spatial, that is, synchronic dimension. As one of the shortest and at the same time capacious definition could be used the formula proposed by Monica Costera. Interregnum is a liminal period of unknown durability characterized by fundamental uncertainty and many compelling questions. Mezhenko is very close to this definition, saying, our epoch is especially interesting and valuable because it resolutely refused to understand what is old. The revolutionary epoch is not looking for tradition. The old is for history, but we are in the present. The present hasn't happened yet, so contemporary art has to be one that has still not happened. In general, describing various literary generations, Mezhenko prefers an opposition old and new, but not old and young. Not age, but poetics and worldview form the basis of this distinction. It's not even about rethinking tradition. A new generation had to start from the level zero, defining the very notion of liturgy. Mezhenko said in 1919, new forces emerged, but they did not bring familiar tradition. They start everything all over again. And liturgy is going through a great crisis because the old is not accepted and the new does not exist. And once again, Ukrainian poetry has really gone through a revolution, denied all of the past. It's creating now the new that is not linked to the idea of the past and cannot be evolutionary deduced from previous phenomena. Not only liturgy, but also everyday life had lost its habitual order lines. If for a liturgy it was a chance, for everyday life it was first of all a challenge. As can be seen from archival documents, the government changed in the country more often than the official forms. You could see here, maybe not see, but here. Yes, two words are crossed, People's Republic, and here is written Ukrainian state. Yes, that is an official documents, but the change were very quickly. So in the situation of chaos, nothing was safe and secure. To complete the library collection, Mezhenko had to give a special permission for traveling by train, for example, and even for carrying vikpont. You could see these documents here on the screen. And as a background are also used historical photos of Kyiv of this period. The everyday life in Kyiv has been also disorganized, particularly through lack of heating, labor mobilization, and confiscation of property. A new social reality that required understanding through liturgy did not help it to develop a cultural institution at all. The next document clearly explained a place of liturgy in everyday life as seen from Mezhenko point of view. This is a description of Mezhenko personal belongings as for August 1920. Summer and winter clothes, underwear and sleepwear, bed clothes, and a private library of 1,150 volumes. Working as literary critic and bibliographer, Mezhenko combined two views of literary reality. From one side, he focused on the uniqueness of the moment and importance of individual creativity, underlined severance and singularity of literature, stressed a role of an individual person in a process of inventing new poetics and literary conventions. From the other side, he classified unique works by systematical principles, validated it from historical perspective, described coherence of literary tradition, and created a discursive field as a common readership. In his introductory lecture for future librarians in 1920, he explained an importance of library in such a way. Yeah, it's here. The value of the library is not the sum of the values of whose books of which it's composed. It's much more. The book in the library, becoming part of the curated selection, becomes more highly valued than it was independently. It becomes more immediate and more understandable. And now several words about Mezhenko librarian or library career. The first official document for Yuri Mezhenko as representative of the Library and Archive Department of the Ministry of Education of the Ukrainian People's Republic is signed on May 31, 1918. And in August 1918 was signed the National Library Fund Act. In summer the same year, Mezhenko became co-head of the Ukrainian Library Congress Organizing Commission and co-head of the Ukrainian Library Census. Mezhenko archives offer us very interesting document clarifying his own role in the process of establishing the National Library. First of all, we could find here working papers with reasons for founding of the National Library of the Ukrainian state. Secondly, working papers for the State Library Act. and also working papers for the Ukrainian National Library Regulations. What means that Mezhenko was the central person who initiated this process of establishing the National Library, and he also prepared the basis for this official act. We could also find authorized printed copy of the Ukrainian National Library Act as proposed by Library and Archive Department. And Mezhenko also prepared an official report as for January 1st, 1919, which says that National Library was established, but it was limited by sources. This National Library at that time exists with just several hundreds of books and limited staff, one librarian and one collaborator. Then Mezhenko decided to initiate establishing of one more institution, and namely Ukrainian Book Chamber. In January 24, 1919, the Ukrainian Book Chamber Act, initiated by Ivan Ohienko, was signed. This document was approved by the Council of People Ministers of the Ukraine, and the head was Volodymyr Vennechenko, but the author of the explanatory note, as we could realize thanks to Mezhenko archive, was Yuri Mezhenko. The political authority in Ukraine was changed very quickly, and in February 18, 1919, the Soviet authority also decided to support this initiative. In February 1919 was signed a Soviet decree on the establishment of the main book chamber with Yuri Ivanov Mezhenko as the head of this institution. But in September of 1919, Mezhenko was forced to apply for the merger of the Book Chamber and National Library because of the Denikin pressure regime. In autumn 1919, he moved with Ukrainian government to Kamianets and then to Berdychev and Vinnytsia, but he returned to Kyiv very quickly. In January 20, 1920, he became director of the Book Chamber, and in September of the same year, he became a head of the Librarian Council of the National White Library of Ukraine. I mean, he is here, Всенародна бібліотека, not national, but maybe it's not the best translation. And being a head of two institutions, Mezhenko realized several projects. First of all, he proposed new structure and principle of the National Library. Secondly, he approved system of classification. He also opened a reading room and established the project of Ukrainika. It's a special project dedicated to classification all the book published in Ukrainian language since the publication of the first part of Eneida by Kotlyarevsky. And as we know, during the end of 1920s, beginning and 1921, the number of books increased to 960,000 volumes. The Soviet changes was not so successful and supportive in the history of National Library and Book Chamber at its look for the at the beginning. Because as we know, in 1919, Kharkiv became a capital of Soviet Ukraine. And the Soviet government started to establish new institutions in Kharkiv and very often to close the old one, the previous one, in the offices in Kyiv. In March 1922, Mezhenko was fired from a job at the National Library. And in November 1922 was signed a resolution on the Ukrainian Book Chamber, which established institution in Kharkiv and closed the Kyiv office. So, In January 1923, Mezhenko started with a new initiative. He decided to create the Ukrainian Book Research Institute and became a director of this institute. But since 1929, he has been under very strong political pressure, and in 1931, fired from a job at the Ukrainian Book Research Institute and forced to move to Leningrad. I could stop with the history, with the story of Mezhenko here, but I don't like to forget about his literary critics activity. Why Mezhenko is so important for literary development? He was the first literary critics who react to Tichina poetry. His review dedicated to Tichina's Sonichni Klarnete underlines the main important things which Tichina brings not only to Ukrainian poetry but also to the European tradition. The second discovery the second author who was discovered by Mezhenko was Mykola Chvilyovyy. And finally, he was a person who forced Plushnik, Yevhen Plushnik, to publish his poetry and who will also dedicate two reviews to Plushnik poetry. To be short, I just would like to say that Mezhenko defined poetry or poetics by Tichina as a musical poetics. He described Mykola Chvilyovyy's works as anthropological projects. And finally, he defined poetics by Yevhen Plushnik as a silent poetics. In one of these early writings, oh, that is how Mezhenko works with Tichina poems, yes, it's music of words. I will skip this part dedicated to the poetry, but it's a very interesting story. It's a parallel to his librarian's story. I just would like to say that in 1919, Mezhenko said that revolution has two stages, destructive and creative. But finally, he experienced two stages of revolutionary reality, creative and destructive. Very interesting is also to analyze Mezhenko's memoirs as written in middle 30s and also in the 1944-1945. About 10 years, even more, 13 years, he has lived in Leningrad and works in the library. His dream was to return to Ukraine. And the first chance he got in the beginning of 1945. And for the second time, he started to develop the National Library of Ukraine. I will skip several quotations, but only one I would like to comment. He wrote in the October of 1944 that he is dreaming to die in Ukraine. He would like to do something useful for his homeland. And he said that it was not his idea to move from Ukraine, yes, and he was forced to do that, and he is dreaming about writing the memoir. And that is interesting. He wrote that, "I will give it to the manuscript department of the Library of Ukraine. This library should exist. I have to establish it." So in my presentation, I try to analyze only one case. It's a case of very strong interconnection between individual and institution. As for Mezhenko, the National Library was an idea of his own life, the whole life of Mezhenko. From one side, he understands that liturgy is something really unique and individual. But from the other side, he understands also that to build new tradition in time of revolution means to classify, to create discourse, and to found institution. And even if political regimes are changed, institution could still exist. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Olena, for a truly fascinating story of the contribution that Mezhenko has made, his legacy to Ukrainian cultural life and to the present day. As I was looking at, just looked into the encyclopedia before, into the internet before yesterday, to see if the name of Mezhenko exists. It does, but barely so. So before us, there is a great deal of work that you need to be done, because neither Mezhenko nor Yefremov, not to a great extent, not very much about Krymsky, exists in world knowledge. That those tools that unfortunately are the tools that we must use. So we must keep that in mind for the future. Number two, what Mezhenko represented and what Mezhenko did by establishing institution and the others who worked on the institutions of UVAN and the Shevchenko Scientific Society is something that we are confronted today with. We're dealing with the same problems. We have archives, we have libraries, and we have to preserve them. We have an Academy of Sciences, UVAN, here. We have had an interesting paper today on what is being done in Cleveland. And there are other archival materials. We must preserve them for posterity, and we must work on them. That lies before us. Now, I'm not as eloquent as Marta Bohachevsky-Chomiak, so I shall open now the floor for discussion and would like very much if you would identify yourself as you speak up. Dr. Ilnitsky.
Oh, yes. Thank you very much for three very interesting papers. I'm struck by this focus on individuals in contrast to the actual historical events. The revolution, the Russian revolution, the Ukrainian revolution, the civil war, represents a dizzying change of regimes and social situations. And yet, I think one of the things that you have demonstrated in these three papers is that there is a paradoxical continuity here. And the continuity is through the individual. And I think that many, let's say, of the conflicts and problems that we see in later in the 1920s could be explained by the fact that we have individuals who sometimes sided with previous regimes, who had professional lives in previous regimes, and who carry this legacy into new situations. So so my question is the same question to all three presenters, is in the case of you, the person you spoke about, to what degree has that person carried his own history through the change of regimes, and how has that history, in fact, changed the success of regimes?
I found the papers most intriguing and interesting. In particular, I think one of two of the individuals that were discussed on this panel focused on the fact that these personalities were not Ukrainians by origin. And I'm very happy that you have stressed that, because there is a tendency to focus on ethnic Ukrainians. When I was a student here, ethnic Ukrainians or ethnic Poles was never used. Interestingly enough, one of the most eminent Polish historians of the and political activists of the 19th century, Joachim Leliwol, mentioned that there is not a drop of blood. There's not a drop of Lach in me. And then he goes on, you know, my mother on my mother's side, her father was a pure Rusyn. On the other side, Prussians and Swiss. Yet, Leliwol was considered as the, so to speak, quintessential Pole in the 19th century. So I think it's about time that we eliminated once again the word ethnic Ukrainian or ethnic Pole from our discourse. Now, my question is addressed not so much to the speakers as to the organizers. As a student of Soviet history, for many years here at Columbia, I have been used to the phenomenon of a non-person in history. One could read a history of the Bolshevik Revolution without even one mention of Trotsky. And obviously, everybody knows why. We are commemorating the 100th anniversary of the Ukrainian Revolution. We are at the end of the first day. And here, too, Hrushevsky becomes a non-person. And as I said, this is not addressed to the speakers. My question is to the organizers. What is responsible for this? And from what I see in the program, we are not going to meet Hrushevsky tomorrow either, as a person, as an individual. Is it because I doubt there is anyone here, or not too many people are present, who have still remember the 1966 article by Professor Pritzak, in which he dethroned Hrushevsky as a political leader. But this is only one individual, and whatever his reasons were, this is not the time to discuss it. I call, that is, once to attention, once again, if we are organizing a conference commemorating an important event in history, which has been almost forgotten in Soviet history, whoever will be organizing a similar conference, it is inconceivable to me that it could be organized without an individual that is the leading personality as a political leader, as a political thinker. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anna. I would like to answer this first. You always put me on the spot. I can't answer this question because I do not represent the organizers. But I just hope that perhaps by the end of the conference, someone might address that question and give you an answer, what the reasons were for the particular choice of lectures and papers, and then we can proceed from that. Definitely, I would have liked, for example, to hear about Khuiluvi, but that's, you know, my personal interests. So now may I, I would like to, but it is a legitimate question, and of course, I hope that someone will be willing to answer that for you. Now, may I, since the question, your question was addressed to the panel, so I have skipped a little bit the order of things, would you like to answer that question first, and then we will proceed? Professor Ilnitsky had a question, right, to the panel. Yes?
I'll start. Let me just say, Hrushevsky is not the only one missing here. What about Petlura?
Yes.
The name, the list of names not here is much longer than the list of names here, and I don't think that's a fault of the organizers. There aren't conferences long enough to put them all in. But to get to Oleg's question, there is it's a good point, that is the continuity. But you know, I'm just thinking about this in Yefremov's case. As you saw from my approach, I see him biographically rather than politically, because obviously all of his political activity, of which there was a great deal, he's the organizer of a political party, that's why he's the associate head of the Verkhovna Rada, he's done a great deal of politicking in his life, which all has to come to an end after 20. That is, once he gets amnesty, that is, he's actually in Kyiv all this time, and he's living illegally there. He's going to get arrested, and heaven only knows what's going to happen. But sometime in 1921, for reasons that I don't really understand who did what, but he gets amnesty with other people. That is, the regime was letting people back in. And all of a sudden, he's a public figure again. He can appear in KU, right? But he can't go into politics. And he's extremely hostile to the Bolsheviks. So he goes into scholarly activity. But he continues doing, you know, the bulk of Yefremov's activity was as a publicist. This is a man, every organization he was part of, he would be the recording secretary, right? That is, he's a writer, he's a propagandist, right? He was one of the major authors for the Ukrainian press, that is, in those years, right? From 1905 all the way up to and through the revolution. And that's what he can do best. That is, he can write, he can be a publicist. But of course, what kind of publicist can you be in a Soviet regime, right? So you have to move all of your publicistic work in, you know, you gotta move it over into a different category. You can't write political propaganda for the daily press the way, you know, Yefremov is the author of, you know, almost all the articles that appeared in the Ukrainian press that were critical of anti-Semitism when the Bayless trial is taking place. Yefremov is writing about this all the time, trying to defend the idea, and this is a trial based on the principle that Ukrainians are anti-Semites, right? And he is writing in the Ukrainian press, in Ukrainian, trying to show that the attack against Bayless is false, right? And thereby defend. Well, you can't do the same something similar in the 23. Right, you can't defend the Ukrainian idea against Marxist accusations of whatever they're going to accuse you of. So he channels his, he becomes much more of a scholar in the 20s than he was in the pre-revolutionary years. But, you know, that is, you have to change things, but it's the biographical qualities of the person that determine what he's going to keep doing. You know, and I think Krymsky is probably another example of this. That is, with a slight shift, you keep doing what you're good at.
Thank you, Maxim. Anyone else that likes to answer that question?
About the question of the institutions of the state and the individual, what I found striking, we look back at the from the eyes of the 30s, when you had a strong state. There was, in the 20s, when these guys are in the academy, they're saying, Krymsky is saying, or actually, some of Yefremov and others would think, well, the Soviets, in Vernadsky's letter, he says, Krymsky thinks that Soviets are here to stay, but actually I think they might not be here very long. Everybody was, it was a very loose touch-and-go situation. I was struck by how these people were not afraid to speak their minds, willing to ridicule some of the party officials. They really didn't realize who they were dealing with, and obviously a strong state was in the process of being made, but in the 20s they had a lot of, the individual really had a lot to decide. As far as Krymsky goes, for me, I wonder, I mean, what difference did he make, you know, because his work was destroyed. I mean, in the 30s, the academy was essentially replaced by people that were not true scholars or that were political. It was really completely subverted. And we have a great memory of him, of course. His memory is almost an icon, which, again, I'm ambivalent about. But it's a question, it's a problem. As far as the ethnic Ukrainian, whatever, I mean, Krymsky, and I mean, this is much more of a thing nowadays because many Ukrainians who are Russified or not of Ukrainian blood identify with as political Ukrainians. Okay, at that time it was a very different situation. I mean, there was the problem of language in the academy, for example. Vernadsky and others wanted to have Russian as also language. It was like basically everybody, even Vernadsky, should be Ukrainian, but there was a fight for maybe given a quota for Russian, maybe so much for Russian, you know. It's a completely different situation because we had an Narod basically that spoke Ukrainian to a large extent. Very different situation from today, of course. But I don't like to say that, I mean, he was an exceptional person. I mean, most Ukrainians are ethnic Ukrainians. That don't have to be, but they just happen to be. I mean, but you know, so I wouldn't say that. Oh, this means that this is that all Ukrainians have an artificial whatever, something that happened in their youth or something, some ideas they had, and they become attached to the Ukrainian idea. There's very, very many individual situations occur.
In case of Mezhenko, it's clearly understood that he needed official support for creating such an institution as National Library. And what we know, I tried to show something on the screen, but it was not enough of time to comment all of these moments. Mezhenko was strongly supported by Mykola Shrach, who was his friend for a very long time and who participated in the Centralna Rada, and then also he supported him in the first time then the early Soviet, even in the Soviet, early Soviet period. And so Mezhenko contacted with Mykola Shrach. He knew him from the child years from Chernihiv. So he used this personal connection to get support for this project. What we know about Mezhenko and politics, political discourse. Firstly, Nadia Strashenets, who is a research worker at National Library, said in her monograph that Mezhenko started to edit political publication in time. Then he was in Kamyanets and then Berdychi Vinnytsia, but he finished it very quickly and he go back to Kyiv to work with National Library. The secondly attempt of the kind of compromise is his article published in 1921. Maybe only one time he tried to combine literary studies and also a Soviet ideology, I would say. It's like just several theoretical remarks, and it's one of the not very important and not very interesting articles written by Mezhenko. After that, Mezhenko refused to try to cooperate in this way, and for example, 1 year or 2 year later, he published a remarkable article on the road to the new theory. He support formalistic approach to the liturgy and not only his idea of the national culture, but also his idea of formalistic approach to the liturgy became a reason for pressure and critics from the side of the authorities. And it's also interesting for me that this period between 1921 for Mezhenko was not very successful and happy, but then he write his memoirs in Leningrad in 1945. He wrote that it was the most successful and must so it was a period of very of happiness in his life. Yes, not only because he did what he liked to do, but also because he feel himself like on his own place. And that was the most important for him. And this interrelation between individual and also authority was not very successful even after the Second World War. Then Mezhenko moved to Ukraine in 1945. He started to develop National Library and also the project Ukrainica. He differentiated between National Library as an institution which collect all the books and magazines and so on, published in Ukraine in different languages, and also Ukrainica is a project which tried to gather different Ukrainian language editions. But he was persecuted, and his colleague Yaroslav Dashkevich was imprisoned in that time, and Mezhenko had a heart attack and also forced for the second time to move to Leningrad. Maybe it was also because he was in Leningrad in the 30s, that is why he was not persecuted in 33 or 36.
I have one question for Victor. You mentioned at the very beginning an interesting fact that Krymsky did not like research. His studies, and specifically the study of the Arab literature, indicates quite a thorough research of his sources. So is it maybe that not the fact that he was not really a research-oriented person, but that he was a multifaceted person, that he didn't want to be pegged into a hole of simply a scholar when he was an organizer and, of course, a fairly major writer. I mean, come through in your presentation about him is that he actually wrote significant both poetry and prose. I just wonder if you would agree with that, or you still think that he didn't like research.
No, I think he was. He did like to survey and present knowledge, but he also did reshuffle and come up with interesting insights as well. I mean, I'm not sure, but I mean, some of his writings, some of his in Ukrainian. Language are quite detailed or real research. There's quite linguistics. So he was able to do that, but he was just very perhaps it was the national thing that he didn't want to go to Petersburg to become an Orientalist, a true international Orientalist, and he wanted to be in Ukraine and be part of this whole thing, which he was extremely extremely strikingly attached to.
Thank you. Would you identify yourself?
Hi, I'm Wayne. I'm from the neighborhood. The theory of the interregnum is very interesting. And I keep wondering if a way to describe the current time and why everyone's going crazy, perhaps that on a very basic level, we're living in a kind of an interregnum in which the post-war period is finally dying, not just politically, but as a frame of mind. And we really don't know what's going to replace it, and that's why everyone's freaking out.
Just short.
Thank you.
I thought the same thing, actually.
Thank you. Anyone else?
But very short
question.
Very short comment. Why I also appeal to this, refer to this interregnum theory. It's very interesting for me that people usually try to skip the circumstances, but in this case we have something different. A person who tried to be involved in this situation, and for him it was a chance to build new tradition, not be limited by circumstances, not be limited by previous tradition, not be limited by something, and try to use this chance. And what is interesting, he not just find himself in this situation, he put himself in this situation. In 1917, when he moved from Moscow, he got job in Moscow, and it was really good job, and he decided to move to Kyiv and to start from the very beginning. Not only his own life, but the life of this city, I would say, in some sense. And secondly, in 1945, he did the same. He finally got a really good job and very good living conditions. And he decided, and he tried several times to go back to Kyiv and also to be in this very stressful situation, but at the same time a situation which could be changed by individual personal efforts.
Дякую.
Yes. There's one more question?
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Thank you. Maria Rybakovich.
For Viktor Ostapchuk. Krymsky traveled to the Middle East quite a bit. Is there any documentation, anything he wrote about, that we could, from that, get a sense, what was his attitude toward those nations? I mean, he loved Ukraine, right, and knew that Ukraine is like had a colonial status. So I wonder if there are any notes, you know, how he felt about those Middle Eastern nations.
There are many letters that he wrote from Beirut and to his family. I haven't really read them, so I can't tell you. But he was quite interesting. He seemed to be very involved in where he was and what he was seeing around him at the time. I was looking for things about Ukraine at the time. What was going on, I couldn't find anything. You know, it's really interesting. Obviously, a very complicated person.
Victor, but he was also a poet in his own right?
Of course, he was a poet.
So
I mean, His poem about Hija has been considered to be sort of a variation on Arabic and poetry, imitation is sort of is considered unique in world literature in some sense. I mean, Yaroslav Stetkevich has, of course, studied this. He was an Ukrainian Arabist. So he was, again, a remarkable individual, I must say. I mean, one of the things I maybe didn't get out is that, you know, it's not easy to, from one hand, it's Krymsky, his writings are old and outdated and so forth, and it's problematic that we're spending so much time on him. But on the other hand, when you look at him, he's not a person that's easy to dismiss, easy to forget. Whether it's his role in the academy or his role in the development of the Ukrainian language or in Oriental studies as well, when one reads his stuff, one finds very fresh, interesting insights. Thanks to his not just his huge erudition, but also his ability to rethink, to look at things differently originally. So it's really quite I'm very grateful that I had the chance to explore Krymsky more than I ever did. I never really took him all that seriously, considering the work that I do. But it's quite so. I mean, it's quite. I mean, he is an amazing, amazing individual. I must say that we should. And it's again, no one has been able to yet really write a proper biography of him, which is interesting. Shows you his complexity, his vastness as an individual.
Has anybody ever considered studying how the Galicians, the Halichane, who went to Ukraine in the 1920s, what their actual relationship was with the Ukrainian intelligentsia. Is there enough material to go on that? And with the big discussion of the integration of the various parts of Ukraine into one body, was there any discussion of that in the 20s and 30s?
You wanted the question.
Well,
I'm not aware of specific studies like that. That is, obviously, some of the individuals have been studied, and you know, they had what careers they had, whether you know whether it was political, literary. It was mostly literary. Right? It was mostly cultural people who did this. But I don't think anybody has studied kind of, you know, as a group. But then as a group, they probably don't share very many characteristics other than coming from the West. That is, it's a diverse group of people.
Yes, very short comment. Yeah. It's not directly my answer. Oh, sorry.
No, okay.
Yeah, can I? Not directly answering the question, yeah, but in the same field. In case of Mezhenko once again, yes, as I said, then he moved to Kyiv in 1945. He started to create the catalog for this project, Ukrainika. And the copy of this catalog was also created in Lviv in the library, National Library, yes, Stefanik Library now, yes, actually. And after ideological critique, then Mezhenko moved to Leningrad again. Kievan catalog was destroyed, but not the copy in Lviv. And at the beginning of 90s, the group of Lviv researchers start once again to develop this project. And what we have now, 11 or even 12 volumes were published with these materials. That is the story of Kyiv and Lviv. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Mark?
Yeah. This is not really a question, but it's sort of to answer Anna Protzik's complaint to the organizers.
Good, thank you.
And I won't speak on behalf of Marco, but I'll try to give my own explanation for why Hrushevsky may not be here. Actually, he is with Hristiuk. Hristiuk, I mean, dedicates it to a large degree to Hrushevsky, and Hrushevsky is all throughout Hristiuk's history. But Hrushevsky is the only major figure in the Ukrainian Revolution for which we have not just one, but two English language biographies, Primax and Plokhi's sort of biography. And this is partly a self-indictment as well as everybody else in the room, but there is no other Ukrainian figure who has an English language biography to this date, 100 years later. Not Vinichenko, not Petlura, not Skoropadsky even, not anybody. So
not even on the internet.
So this is part of our bigger problem, that the English language public has nothing to read. That is equivalent to biographies of Lenin and Trotsky and Miliukov and Kerensky and any number of other people. Even Rasputin has more biographies than any Ukrainian activist of 1917. So I don't know if that's in defense of Mark, but it's my explanation for why there's no Hrushevsky here, because we already have Hrushevsky, and he's the only one we do have. We need a lot more people.
Just two short comments with sort of question. I wanted to mention one more person who is not here on this panel, whom definitely should be, which is Les Kurbas, of course. And this is partly about the West and the East. If most of the Galician emigres to Soviet Ukraine came in the 20s, some came earlier, and this is the theater. People, and they had a very, very good relations with the theater intelligentsia. They actually created a new theater in Ukraine, and it is Kurbas and Krushelnitsky and Buchma and Hirniak. And so there was that, certainly, for sure. But I want to return to Krymsky because he's such an underappreciated and undervalued person. There is one interesting issue, and I wonder if you would have a comment to that. Krymsky is one of the few people who stayed in Ukraine and survived the 30s. And the question is why? And of course, I wonder if you have a suggestion, and I have one suggestion, because...
Give me your suggestion.
He was killed by proxy. He was killed by... in absentia, so to speak.
Yeah.
His lover and his personal secretary was arrested instead of him, and he was sort of being blackmailed and in many ways tried to conform so that his lover will not be executed. Mm-hmm. And eventually he was let go, but he committed suicide right after that. Mm-hmm. So this is another his story of really a diabolical kind of moral execution rather than physical execution of a person. And in this, I think he is an example of another facet of the terror.
Yeah. Well,
Stalinist terror.
I mean, what's interesting about him is that. I was also wondering why he survived the late 30s. I mean, that's when he should have gone, right? And yet he was in so-called Krymsky of Opalu. Krymsky was in I don't know, ostracized, whatever, he's completely out. But all of a sudden in 39, when the Soviets moved into Western Ukraine, he was revived. He went to Lviv and was shown, he was obviously had great prestige and so forth. So. That doesn't mean they couldn't have done away with him, but he came back. He even got a Order of the Red Banner in 1941, just before he died, and he had to go through the whole charade of getting this thing. And interestingly enough, and there's actually a picture I didn't show of him with his banner, very proud of this medallion. But Pritsak had a story that Krymsky told him that when he came to pick up this medal. He leaned over to kiss it, but he said, told Pritsak that actually what I did was I spat at it. Well, couldn't have actually spat at it because it would have shown, but he must have made the motion or something, you know. Because he was obviously this is a dream that he hated to the core, you know. But yet and then, of course, a few months later, he was arrested, taken from Zvenihorodka, taken by a car to Kyiv. That was last seen on a bridge. Eventually, we found out we know that he died in Kustanai in Kazakhstan in a hospital. So he was eventually liquidated. But yes. Yeah.
But he was born in Kazakhstan, right?
No, he was born in Volynia.
Volynia,
yeah.
And I must have read it somewhere, misread it, but think probably he died. That's why.
Okay, maybe that's going to be the last question.
Okay, I actually
You have to?
No, that's fine.
Okay. As I listen to your presentations, it seems to me that the individuals that you presented to us, they all had that urge to return to Ukraine, despite it's probably maybe especially true of Mezhenko, to Ukraine, despite other opportunities. I mean, Krymsky worked in Moscow, from what I remember. And I think Maxim mentioned that the Iefremov also were somewhere. No? Okay, so maybe he's the only one. But it seems to me that they all wanted to go. Do you think that it's because they felt that they could make a difference? Or is it just like pure love of Ukraine? What do you think?
Well, it had to be. I mean, in the case of Krymsky, he sacrificed almost 10 years. Running the Academy of Sciences, doing scholarship, teaching at the same time. He had this amazing drive. It's quite hard to fathom how he could have done it, actually, you know. And if I had known, I cut some things out, I would have talked more about Khrushchev because I had more about him and the war. If I had known, the problem would come up. But because their battle was also quite, you know, and both, I mean, it was basically a structural problem, but also there were personality issues, and who was there first, Krymsky was there first, and Hrushevsky wanted to basically abolish the Academy and start over again. He wanted to be more humanitarian, Ukrainian-centered thing, whereas Krymsky was following Vernadsky's basically line of the full Academy, covering all branches of scholarship. But anyway.
Well, Marco is not chasing us, so maybe one more question.
Yeah, okay. You wanted to say something?
Yeah. Just very short, okay. Yeah, I would say that at the very beginning of this career, in the 1918-19, as it's seen from the quotation, Mezhenko really felt that he and his colleagues can change something in the situation. But, for example, in the 30s, he also call his own feeling of this place, I mean Kyiv, as lyrical pathos. Somewhere here, yeah. This is what is called lyrical pathos in a work. So I have not enough of time to analyze all of this text, and I decide to skip this part because they are written a bit later, not in 20s, but they are very interesting. They are giving very interesting perspective. And I also understand that what is written in memoirs, it's not like a true, yes? It's what we remember and how we explain for ourselves, our life, and different events, decisions, and so on.
Thank you.
I can speak to this issue as well. One of the most fascinating questions is people like Yefremov, Chikalenko, the people who keep diaries. Yefremov got arrested, I think, 7 times in his life, most of them by the Tsarist police. He burned diaries when he saw that he's going to get arrested and his diaries are going to incriminate him. And from 23 to 27, he is writing such a remarkably free diary that is, those of us who have read this, you read this and you go, my God, you could say this in the 20s? Well, he didn't say this in the 20s. He wrote it in his diary. That is, and I mean, all the scholars who deal with self-writing know perfectly well the diaries aren't really private. But these diaries, everyone who looks at them knows immediately, and Yefremov talks about it in the diary, you obviously can't let this become public because I get shot if this becomes public. And he knows this, and he occasionally mentions this, and you'd have to study them very carefully. There are things he doesn't say in his diary deliberately because they would be so incriminating that someone dies immediately if the diaries come out. And of course, the diaries get denounced, right? That is, when Yefremov gets arrested, one of his colleagues who knows where the diary, because he doesn't keep them in his house. They're hidden somewhere, right? But someone knew, and of course, that's the only reason we have them today, is because Yefremov was arrested, his diaries became material against them, and they were saved, and today they exist. But how in the world can a man keep writing diaries like that and say the things about the regime that he says, knowing full well that if this diary ever makes it into the wrong hands, I'm a dead man?
But I think there was a progression as the 20s went on. I think earlier on, I don't think he would have been so afraid of the things. He wrote some outrageous things, jokes about how right after Lenin died, in Moscow, the sewers burst under Lenin's mausoleum and the whole thing. Now he's all covered in shit. Now he wrote all stuff. And it seems to me, I had a sense that there was a progression of. And it's also towards Krymsky, from what the earlier parts of his diary, Krymsky later on, towards the end.
Sexuatis is from 25. Is
25, okay. Well, yeah. But I was an impression more that they were a team, actually. As far as dealing with Hrushevsky.
They work much better, in fact, than the diaries make it sound.
Probably, yeah. That's another thing, yeah.
But
yeah,
I guess what I find
doesn't say much about his character.
Is how someone can go on doing this. He's not a stupid man. Just burn them.
There was just no TV and internet those days, so people had a lot of things to do. They had nothing to do in their spare time.
That is, he kept diaries before 1895, for example. We know he did, and he talks about having burned them in advance of an expected arrest by the Tsarist police. Right, and for reasons that aren't entirely clear, this one year it wasn't at hand when he was burning the other ones, so he didn't get a chance to burn it, and then later it didn't matter because it didn't get into the hands of the police. But that is, coming from, like Hrushevsky's return, right, like the Galicians who all go, that is, what motivates these people in circumstances, by the end of the diary in 26, 27, he knows exactly what he's facing, right? And he knows that this diary can kill him.
All right, Victor. I'm interested just at the end. We have had our own very distinguished Orientalist at Harvard, and I would like to know, do you know anything about the relationship or between Pritzak and Krymsky that can kind of conclude our vision of Krymsky?
Pritzak had a short, he was formerly his student, his aspirant, his graduate student in 39, 40. And so they met, so, but of course it didn't last very long, unfortunately, but yes. There are interesting, I mean, I don't want to get into it, but there could be interesting parallels between Krymsky and Pritzak in a lot of ways, because both of them, I mean, were great Orientalists, and both of them were very interested in the Ukrainian idea. And some people have thought this was to the detriment of Omelyan Pritzak's scholarship, which I think is unfair, though there is something to be said for it. I mean, similarly, I mean, Krymsky also, he probably could have been an international figure if he'd stayed in Orientalism, and he would have written in Russian, and it all would have been translated, but probably not in the Western languages as well, like Bartold, for example. But it didn't happen for Krymsky because he made that choice. But I don't really see it as a fraught choice, because if you look at these both individuals, what they did, and whether it's, you know, maybe controversial, it's always very interesting and original, and that's what scholarship is all about, reshuffling knowledge. You know.
Thank you. Thank you to our panelists and to our public.